One of the main driving factors that has kept me consistently teaching for these many decades is that I find it so difficult to sit in somebody else's class. And not because I'm better than they are, but just because that's who I am. Well, you know, of course, that we live in the age of the woman, right? Woman's rights, women's equality with men. And I think there's a lot of good to be said about that. And you will be happy to know that I, in my extensive research, have found a Bible that is written for women. Hallelujah, Hallelujah, Judy. And it's published in pink, which you will appreciate. Hopefully that's not a put down. And this is a study Bible, and it has 30,000 footnotes in it, designed especially for you women. Okay? I'm going to show you a sample of it. Every footnote is the same. Go ask your husband to explain this to you. This is the Church of Christ Women's Bible. Of course, if you happen to be a widow or divorced or a maiden, you're just going to have to get by without knowing. That's all I can say. I saw that, and I just got a huge chuckle out of it. It would be funnier if it weren't so true in our tradition. I think of all of the ways that we have misinterpreted Scripture and taken things out of context, that probably the way that we have treated our women and the way we have hindered the full exercise of the gifts that the Holy Spirit has given them is perhaps one of the most unforgivable things in our history. All right, you're welcome. On a less frivolous note, as you know, I keep up with some of the literature concerning the persecution of the church today. And I just found this article that I found this week. As the title says, horrific. And we know that this is happening. We see it in the news, but it's hard to fathom the extent of it. And this has to do with what's happening in Nigeria and has been happening for a considerable period of time now. 43,000 Christians killed, 18,500 abducted, 17,500 churches attacked in Nigeria. This is reported by a group known as the Inter-Society. They report that Islamic terrorism against Christians, 10 million people uprooted, 6 million forced to leave their homes, 4 million displaced. This is in Nigeria. At least 43,000 Christians killed, 18,500 Christians permanently disappeared, 17,500 churches attacked, 2,000 Christian schools attacked. Killings emanated from the propagation of radical Islamism. Terror groups, including Boko Haram, Islamic State, West Africa Province, and the jihadist Fulani, among others, but those are the primary ones. Some of the atrocities of the jihadists include massacres, killings, and beheadings, mutations, mutilations, torture, maiming, slitting of throats and wounds, abductions, disappearances, hostage taking, rape, girl-child defilements, forced marriages, forced conversions, extortions, forceful occupation of farmlands, destruction and forceful harvesting of farm crops, destruction or burning of homes, worship centers, and learning centers. When we think about Christian persecution, we want to think about the first century or the medieval age or those times, but as we've said several times, there's never been a time in the history of the world where more martyr blood has flowed than it does today. We live in a bubble. We don't have any idea how fortunate and blessed we are as Christians to have the freedom of worship that we have without fear of. And we pray that that will continue, knowing, of course, that we have no guarantee that it will. So we left off a few weeks ago, right at the end of James 2, finishing up talking about the idea of faith without works. And just as the body is dead without breath, so also faith is dead without good works. The message reads, the very moment you separate body and spirit, you end up with a corpse. Separate faith and works, and you get the same thing, a corpse. And of course, when we talk about works here, we're not talking about do we show up on Sunday morning or Sunday night or Wednesday night. We're talking about how are we living our life? How are we interacting with our society, with our families, our friends, with those who are less fortunate than we, and with those who are more fortunate than we? How do we interact with them? What are our works, our deeds? All right, James chapter 3, and this is a tough one, folks. This is a tough chapter. This is why I'm with Martin Luther. We probably ought to tear James out of the Bible, but we're going to listen to the reading of it first, and then we'll get into the text a little bit, and I have some songs for you along the way. We're way behind on our songs, so we're going to try to catch up a little bit today as time allows. So here's the third James chapter of James.
3. Not many of you should become teachers, my brothers, for you know that we who teach will be judged with greater strictness. For we all stumble in many ways, and if anyone does not stumble in what he says, he is a perfect man, able also to bridle his whole body. If we put bits into the mouths of horses so that they obey us, we guide their whole bodies as well. Look at the ships also. Though they are so large and are driven by strong winds, they are guided by a very small rudder, wherever the will of the pilot directs. So also the tongue is a small member, yet it boasts of great things. How great a forest is set ablaze by such a small fire! And the tongue is a fire, a world of unrighteousness. The tongue is set among our members, staining the whole body, setting on fire the entire course of life, and set on fire by hell. For every kind of beast and bird, of reptile and sea creature, can be tamed and has been tamed by mankind. But no human being can tame the tongue. It is a restless evil, full of deadly poison. With it we bless our Lord and Father, and with it we curse people who are made in the likeness of God. From the same mouth come blessing and cursing. My brothers, these things ought not to be so. Does a spring pour forth from the same opening both fresh and salt water? Can a fig tree, my brothers, bear olives, or a grapevine produce figs? Neither can a salt pond yield fresh water. Who is wise and understanding among you? By his good conduct, let him show his works in the meekness of wisdom. But if you have bitter jealousy and selfish ambition in your hearts, do not boast and be false to the truth. This is not the wisdom that comes down from above, but is earthly, unspiritual, demonic. For where jealousy and selfish ambition exist, there will be disorder and every vile practice. But the wisdom from above is first pure, then peaceable, gentle, open to reason, full of mercy and good fruits, impartial and sincere, and a harvest of righteousness is sown in peace by those who make peace.
Well, anybody in here having trouble with foot and mouth disease? You have any trouble controlling the tongue? James is really a master of the metaphor, isn't he? He uses them continuously and very, very well, very illustrative, and makes the point very strongly. Well, we're going to wade off into this, as unpleasant as it is, because I don't know of any of us that are immune to this. And it's very, very damaging, can be very hurtful. Dear brothers and sisters, not many of you should become teachers. Now, the New Living Version adds in here as a comment in the church. That's not in the text. And I think that we kind of have read it that way many times and maybe gotten a little bit of a misinterpretation of what James is talking about. He's not talking about me to the exclusion of you this morning. I like the NLV, but I think sometimes they get a little bit carried away in their interpretation. For we who teach will be judged more strictly. The subject I would propose to you is not Bible class teachers or preachers or anything nearly as formal as that. Number one, they didn't even have those in the day that James was writing this in the way that we do. But he's talking about all of us and the management of our tongue, the management of the way that we interact with people, because we teach continually, do we not? Mothers teach their children. We teach the people we work with. Somebody says sticks and stones may break my bones, but words will never hurt me. That's totally wrong. Words can completely destroy and do and have and will. And I'm pretty sure that most everybody in here has experienced that at one time or another. And maybe on both sides of the equation, receiving and delivering. Matthew 5 says, teaching, it talks about teaching and doing. Therefore, anyone who sets aside one of the least of these commands and teaches others accordingly would be called least in the kingdom of heaven. But whoever practices and teaches these things, these commandments, will be called great in the kingdom of heaven. Teachers are judged by the words that they speak, but they're also judged by the actions. We're all teachers at some point. And this highlights the power of our words and their power to bless and destroy. So when you read this first verse here and you say, teachers are going to be judged more harshly, you can't sit back and say, whew, I'm glad I'm not a teacher. That's not the subject. The subject is the tongue. How we use that tongue. Indeed, we all stumble. We all make mistakes. For if we could control our tongues, we would be perfect. We would be mature and could also control ourselves in every other way. We can make a large horse go wherever we want by means of a small bit in its mouth. How many of you ever ridden a horse? How many of you plowed behind a horse? I have. Just takes a little pull, a little tug, either way, that bit. How many of us form judgments, first impressions about people by the first things we hear out of their mouth? If you hear somebody who's continually resorting to profanity and vulgarity, How do you judge that person? A small rudder makes a huge ship turn wherever the pilot chooses to go, even though the winds are strong. In the same way, the tongue is a small thing that makes grand speeches, but a tiny spark can set a great forest on fire. Very vivid metaphor. And we see it all the time, don't we? Somebody, especially somebody in authority, can just with a careless word or maybe an ill-conceived word, start a chain of events that has enormous impact. It could be in your family. And many of you have experienced family breakups and problems just because of a few careless words. And you know, a word, once it's spoken, it's like putting toothpaste back into a toothpaste tube. It doesn't go very easy. And how easy it is. And we're all guilty. James says, you're all guilty. I know I am. How many times have you wished, oh, I wish I could take that word back? You know, off the subject, but the fire just reminded me, you may have been watching in the news that, you know, California is having their wildfire like they have every year. And this one that's blazing now in Northern California has completely destroyed our Sierra Bible camp, where I spent so many days and weeks and have such tremendous memories. I hope that they'll be able to at some point rebuild that. It would be terrible to have that go away. Nothing to do with James, but it was just the fire reminded me. Proverbs 26 and 20 says, without wood, a fire goes out. Without gossip, a conflict ceases. Tongues of fire. You know, this is just right down where the rubber meets the road, isn't it? This is practical living, practical Christianity. If we can't identify a Christian from the world by our language, by our tongue, by our vocabulary, then there's something wrong. Well, of course, the song is obvious, right? It's a song that we've all sung forever. I love. I don't know how many times I've led this song just because I love it. What's the song? Come on. Angry words, or let them never. This is an old recording by the David Lipscomb Chorale. Incidentally, ladies, I read in the Christian Chronicle this week that David Lipscomb has just installed their first female president. If I could find that Bible, I'd send her a copy.
Thank you.
Lovely song. Verse 6, and among all the parts of the body, the tongue is a flame of fire. It is a whole world of wickedness, corrupting your entire body. It can set your whole life on fire, or it can set the wheel of life, some versions say, on fire. For it is set on fire by hell itself. James, why don't you say what you mean? Why don't you quit mincing words? You like that picture? Something about duct tape and WD-40? Psalm 120, verse 2, deliver my soul, O Lord, from lying lips and a deceitful tongue. Proverbs 16, 27, a worthless man digs up evil, and his speech is like a scorching fire. Matthew 12 and 36, but I tell you that men will give an account on the day of judgment for every careless word they have spoken. Women, aren't you glad you're excluded from that? Matthew 15, 11, a man is not defiled by what enters his mouth, but what comes out of it. Not anything new here, but I think it's beneficial to be reminded once in a while of the severity and the importance of it. This is another song. It's a country western song by Stonewall Jackson, and I had not heard this song before, but I think the words are really good.
It hurts down deep when angry words are spoken. Because of this, countless tears are shed. Much too often, tender hearts are broken. When hasty, thoughtless, angry words are said. As you know, I stormed out of the house again this morning. I slammed the door and didn't even take your usual kiss. Angry words can make us do things without a warning. I could hardly wait to get back home to tell you this. First of all, you're the reason for my living. You've stuck with me when things were at their worst. We've got the home, the kids, and the joy they're giving. But over all, you always will come first. We found out long ago that life's no paradise. We're not angels, or else we'd all have wings. Above all angry words, I hope you realize that I love you, if that means anything.
We're not angels or we'd all have wings. I love that. Angry words. Verse 7 through 9, don't you like that picture? People can tame all kinds of animals, birds, reptiles, and fish, but no one can tame the tongue. It is restless and evil, full of deadly poison. Sometimes it praises our Lord and Father, and sometimes it curses those who have been made in the image of God. You live in a time where people are very quick to speak, and we all have an international platform. This is something new in the world. This has never before in the history of the world existed. You can get on the internet and express your opinion and be heard around the world. I don't know, the news articles even now on the news channels, the internet channels I'm talking about, many of the news articles have a section under them for comments. I read those for a little while, and I just got so discouraged and disgusted that I thought, man, what's wrong with this world? I quit reading them. I mean, it's just ignorant and harmful and hurtful and obscene and mostly just stupid. Angry words. I think the worst mistake that was made in implementing this interaction on the internet is to ever have allowed anyone to post anonymously. That just opened the floodgates because there's no accountability. But it's just sickening that we have that platform out there. For a Christian, I think the criteria is, does our communication bear witness to the presence of the Holy Spirit within us? Is our language, is our demeanor, is our witness the witness of someone who has the indwelling Holy Spirit living within them? Now, I know we can't any of us be perfect all the time, and we are all going to respond to situations off the cuff and the spur of the moment, and we're going to say things we wish we hadn't said. But can we try to take that tenth of a second to think, is this Holy Spirit driven, or is this coming from the gates of hell? I think so much of what I read and hear, it just comes from the very mouth of Satan himself. Certainly not from the Holy Spirit. And so blessing and cursing come forth, pouring out of the same mouth. Surely, my brothers and sisters, this is not right. There's a spring of water bubble out with both fresh water and bitter water. Does a fig tree produce olives or a grapevine produce figs? No, and you can't draw fresh water from a salty spring. Matthew 7:16, by their fruit you will recognize them. Are grapes gathered from the thorn bushes or figs from the thistles? Matthew 7:20, so then by their fruit you will recognize them. We've mentioned several times how much James relies on the teachings of Jesus himself, and especially the Sermon on the Mount. These both come from the Sermon on the Mount. Negativity, cursing, condemning, bullying, discouraging words cannot come from a Spirit-filled disciple of Christ. Would you agree with that or not? That's hard. Because our spirit wrestles with the Holy Spirit. And sometimes we win. One last time. You'll recognize this one, of course. Same one we had before, just a different group. But I've got the words and the music on the screen for you, and it's a cappella.
Angry words, oh, let them never from the tongue unbridled slip. May the heart's best impulse ever check them ere they swallow the lips. Love one.
one another, thus saith the Savior. Children, obey the Father's blessed command. Love one another, thus saith the Savior. Children, obey the blessed command. Love is much too pure and holy. Friendship is too sacred far. For a moment's reckless folly, thus to desolate and mar. Love one another, thus saith the Savior. Children, obey the Father's blessed command. Love one another, thus saith the Savior. Children, obey the blessed command. Angry words are lightly spoken. Bitterest thoughts are rashly stirred. Brightest links of life are broken by a single angry word. Love one another, thus saith the Savior. Children, obey the Father's blessed command. Love one another, thus saith the Savior. Children, obey the blessed command.
We might do well to have that as the anthem song and stand and salute while it plays. How many problems would it solve if we could contain our tongue? If you are wise and understand God's ways, prove it by living an honorable life, doing good works with the humility that comes from wisdom. So James is going to talk a little bit now about wisdom. But if you are bitterly jealous and there is selfish ambition in your heart, don't cover up the truth with boasting and lying. The word here, wise, is the Greek sophos. It's translated in the Latin as sapiens. Are you familiar with that word? Homo sapiens? What are homo sapiens? That would be me. That would be you. Does that fit us? Is that an appropriate title for us? Wise knowings, ones who know and act accordingly. Wisdom helps you know what to say and when to say it, and when to participate or bow out of situations. This is a good follow-up for his discussion on the tongue, because wisdom is at the core of doing what he's been telling us to do in the preceding verses, isn't it? If you're wise, then you know when to speak and when to shut up. As we learn in pastoral care, never pass up an opportunity to shut up. Never pass up an opportunity to shut up and listen. Wisdom helps us know what to say and when to say it, and when not to say it. Wisdom is the ability to think and act using knowledge, experience, understanding, common sense, and insight. Knowledge and wisdom are not the same thing. Knowledge is what you know. Wisdom is what you do with what you know. We can have people who are extremely well educated, very knowledgeable, have great recall, and not be very wise at all. Have you ever known anybody like that? Some people learn from experience. Some people have the same experience over and over. Wisdom is the ability to foresee the consequences of action, allowing one to avoid negative consequences and producing the desired positive ones. That's a great statement. A person who is exercising wisdom can imagine the effects of what he's about to say or do before he says or does it. and then decide whether or not that's the prudent thing at that time to do. Wisdom is applied knowledge, not just head knowledge. Proverbs 8 and 10, receive my instruction instead of silver, and knowledge rather than pure gold, for wisdom is more precious than rubies, and nothing you desire compares with her. And then he directs his attention to this idea of jealousy and selfishness. Have you ever thought of jealousy and selfishness as twins, part of the same package? For jealousy and selfishness are not God's kind of wisdom. Such things are earthly, unspiritual, and demonic. Yikes. Demonic? Really? Jealousy and selfishness? Demonic? For wherever there is jealousy and selfish ambition, there you will find disorder and evil of every kind. Do you recognize the green eye? You can tell what generation I'm from, can't you? Young people would not have any idea what that meant. Romans 2 and 8, but for those who are self-seeking and who reject the truth and follow wickedness, there will be wrath and anger. What is jealousy? Jealousy is an unhappy or angry feeling of wanting to have what someone else has. An unhappy or angry feeling caused by the belief that someone with whom you have a special relationship likes or is liked by someone else. Have you ever been jealous in your life? But the wisdom from above is first of all pure. It is also peace-loving and gentle at all times and willing to yield to others. It is full of mercy and the fruit of good deeds. It shows no favoritism and is always sincere. Peace-loving, gentle, yielding, merciful. No favoritism. Good deal. Wow. James is asking an awful lot of us, isn't he? And those who are peacemakers will plant seeds of peace and reap a harvest of righteousness. There's a peacemaker. Built by Colt. That's the name of that, by the way. That's the peacemaker. I don't think that's what James had in mind. I just happened to run across it. Seeds of peace and a harvest of righteousness. Those who are peacemakers will plant seeds of peace and reap a harvest of righteousness. That's a peacemaker. That's not my generation, so most of you all won't recognize that if you're in my generation. That's a whole other thing. But anybody recognize that at all? Okay. Wrong picture for the wrong audience. It's a movie. He's the peacemaker. And this is another picture of a peacemaker, which maybe is more appropriate to us. Peace is not necessarily the absence of conflict, but peace is a prerequisite for righteousness. It is difficult to live a righteous life in the absence of peace. Would you agree with that? I like this last statement here. Peace is a sense of sufficiency. If we have a feeling that it's enough, then we have a better chance of being at peace. If we are continually reaching for that unattainable golden ring on the carousel, we're going to have trouble finding peace. All right, good timing. That brings us to the end of chapter 3. We will pick up with chapter 4, Lord willing, next week. Yes? She, what about the potato and the hot tamale?
One of my best friends is from the valley, and we worked for years. And now I get an argument with a fork. And he can suggest you need to be more like a potato instead of a tamale.
You need to be more like a potato instead of a hot tamale. Yeah, there you go. Absolutely. Thank you for your presence, your attention, and have a wonderful God bless week.